Hey everyone, can I have your attention? Hi, I'm back. So I wanted to say thank you guys for all your understanding this semester, because I've been going like crazy on interviews for med school, so I'm finally done with the interview season. So I'll be here for the rest of the semester, I promise. The other thing, SI sessions are like normal, so I hope the exam went decent for all of you. I looked at the grades and all that, so I know it was different, but you made it through, and now you can do that. So there you go. And also, there will be announcements coming up about SI Leader of the Year nominations. My supervisor will be sending stuff out to you, so if you guys feel that any SI you've ever had was good, you can nominate them.
I was being nice, and then she hit me. Okay, so SI session Sunday, Monday, and tonight, no SI session, but Kappa Alpha Theta's catwalk is happening at Carlton Commons at 8:30. So in the off chance that you're here, forbid for your heart with the AFEs, it ends in time for you to go to catwalk. And what do you know? You're halfway to Carlton Commons if you're here. So you should probably go to Carlton Commons. And it starts at 8:30, doors open. Tickets are $3 in advance, $5 at the door. So you should probably show up. Help battered children.
I already bought my ticket. There we go. Oh, here's the song. This is it. I knew it. We've got our Friday afternoon song. We can have Friday afternoon song every Friday. But if you want to listen to your music, you have to bring it. I'm sorry? I don't have any Charlie in the Chocolate Factory with me today. I do have today's Friday afternoon song, though. We'll see if you enjoy this one. Oh, shoot. Oh, it's not authorized to play it. That stinks. Oh, I'll have to talk to my daughter about that. Here we go. Yes, it's illegally downloaded. I could do that. I know I could do that, couldn't I? Yeah, right.
Why are there so many songs about rainbows?
And I will. You will hear this one on the last day of the semester, too.
Oh.
All right. Is this it? Oh, sorry. That's
but that only one's on. Illusions.
There. Does this work better?
Does this thing work?
There we go.
So we've been told and
It's like rubbing the neck on a chicken, right? They all settle down. We're staring at a chicken, they all quiet down. Yeah, it's all right.
Someday we'll find it, the rainbow connection, the lovers, the dreamers, and me.
Actually, Monique, where are you?
Who
Happy
said
bird, right?
That every wish would be
I think, are you out there? Where are you?
When wished on the morning star.
Bird, is that the right place? The
Somebody
URLs you sent me?
Of
I think it's EP Bird.
Someone believed it.
It is on YouTube. I know it's on YouTube.
So
I for some reason, I can't get this thing to work today, so.
What's so amazing that keeps us stargazing?
Not up there,
and
am
what
I?
Do we think?
Oh, you know why I'm not up there?
No. Someday we'll find it.
I'll say it. Sorry. We'll come back to that one. I promise that we'll come back to that one. I will bring that one out at the end of the semester. All right. I have been... We started talking about this one last year, but if you've never seen this video, I do have to do, hang on, I can't do it that way. In order to get the music, I have to do this. No, it's not Britney Spears, no way. Please, come on. I only hear half of the discussion and see what happens to me. All right, if you've never seen the reaction of Diet Coke and Mentos, you've done that one?
Yeah.
If you've never, how do I do this? This way. Can't see a thing. Is it up there again? Come on, wake up, computer. I know, it's Friday, we're relaxing. All right, if you've never seen, you know, some of you may have done it. Somebody just told me yesterday that you can go into the store now and buy Mentos, and they actually have a little plastic tube on them so that you can dump the Mentos into the Diet Coke. This is a reaction that, actually, I have an undergrad who's researching how it works. We're trying to figure out the mechanism. But it's also a reaction that we talked about a year and a half ago when I first got here to say, you know, wouldn't it be cool to get about 200 people to do this? Let's watch it, then I'll tell you what the plan is. Because we're going to do it this year, come. It's probably better on YouTube, isn't it? I'm playing it, I know. Just go to YouTube, probably. Yeah, I can, let me just, it was emailed to me, let's just do it that way. I'm glad it's Friday, we're relaxing a little bit today. Just make sure I don't type my password so you can all see it. I did that last year. No, no one saw the, it was up there short enough that no one was able to write it down. All right, so I'll go to my email. Monique, I got to find it in here. It's in here somewhere. That's all right. Is it the first one or the second one? It's the second one. I didn't like the first one. Where are you, Monique? Thank you. Good to share you already got your reflection in. Those who were at the seminar this afternoon, thank you.
That was fast.
You have a sock still? Like, just happened.
Yes, I'll still take socks.
Kenny, you'll be up there next year.
You have to be nominated first. So. It's not in here. But thank you for the vote of confidence. I must have deleted it, Monique, because I already had it. I'm sorry, it's nothing personal. It was my happy Valentine's, thank you. There we go. There's even a channel for Mentos and Diet Coke now? All right, if you've never seen this video, it's definitely worth watching. Otherwise, I wouldn't have done it. Yeah, I can make it big. Quit buffering, right? Pause it, let it buffer. All right. I'll tell you what the plan is. As I said, we'll watch these two interesting individuals and what they do with Diet Coke and Mentos. Those of you who've seen it, it's a great little reaction. You put the Diet Coke in the Mentos and it sprays nicely. The dream that we had last year was to, take the entire chemistry class during National Chemistry Week, this class, and out on the quad do this reaction with as many people as we could get. So this year what I'd like to do is, if we're going to do it, let's do it right. Let's get all of last year's class and this year's class, every person with a 2-liter bottle of Diet Coke and enough Mentos to make this work, lining the entire quad. And if all goes well, roping President Snyder into running through the arch of Diet Coke and Mentos. That's my job, is to get her there. Your job is to everybody invest in a bottle of Diet Coke and a sleeve of Mentos.
Is 111 doing it too?
111 would, I could invite 111 to do it too. They would like to be there. So, I'm sorry? How big does it have to be in to get into Guinness? I don't know that that we want to do that. We could do that. We could try, but the idea is to have some fun with this. As I said, in my history, I have been known to do one or two crazy things. We put a periodic table on a football field at a Big Ten football game. That was kind of fun.
Why does it have to be like Diet Coke? Could it be like Diet Pepsi? I don't think it would be good.
Well, the issue, one of the reasons, the snags we ran into, is that Pepsi has an exclusive contract on campus. And one of the things I wanted to do was to get someone to pay for it other than us. And so it doesn't work as well with Diet Coke or Diet Pepsi as it does with Diet Coke. So now if you have a, somebody just came online. So if you have a parent or someone who works for the other manufacturer and want to help us out, we can talk. But as I said, I have an undergrad who's researching the mechanism of how this works because it's debated right now. Steve Spangler is a former high school teacher. If you've never been to Steve Spangler's website, I recommend it. He's got some cool stuff on there. He's a former high school teacher in Colorado who does some neat stuff. He has one theory of why this works. The other one is a gentleman by the name of Lee Merrick, who's a former high school teacher from Naperville, Illinois. Lee was part of a group called Weird Science, and Lee has another theory about this, why this works. I don't know that either one is right or that maybe they're both right, so we have to figure that out. So let's see if we can do this. It's buffered a little bit. You know what, if I was on the VPN, it might be a little bit faster, but we'll go ahead. Buffering. All right, we're going to run out of buffering again. So you can go on YouTube and do the search for this one. There's lots of iterations of this now. Lots of people have got their YouTube videos up there. We could have our own. So as I said, the dream would be that we get a couple of 100 people out there with doing this all down the quad. So yes, it will get sticky. You will have to wear your lab coat, goggles, all that stuff, and it will be a mess. There's no avoiding that. So, but that's where we want to go with it. We'll work on that and see what we can do. So, it's good for your witch. Let's see if I kept this. There we go. How's that for transitioning? All right, back to what we were talking about. First of all, those of you who were there this afternoon for the presentations, thank you. You heard the one professor say he thought he might have more speakers than students. That was, quite honestly, one of the concerns when they had to move from a small room to a larger room. So I appreciate the fact that you were there. Please take the time to write a little reflection about what you got out of attending today. Maybe you got nothing out of attending, but that's okay to write. So just take the time to write something for me, email it to me so I have it, and we can go from there. All right. I would like it by the end of the day Monday. This isn't the kind of thing that you should have to sit there and outline and revise and edit. I just want stream of consciousness. So just a short little email is fine. All right, wake up, computer. I'm tired of waiting for you. Equilibrium. Which page am I on? I'm on that one. I need to go to this one. I owe you a grading rubric still for the paper. I am going to spend time on that this weekend. I started to do one, and I said, you know, I need more time. So, as we were saying, we were starting to write the equilibrium. Wake up, computer. There we go. All right. If you take a generic weak acid like acetic acid, and if we label the states of these things, the ions will always be aqueous compounds. The acetic acid itself is an aqueous compound, and the water is a pure liquid. When you write the equilibrium constant for this one, or the equilibrium constant expression, because we don't include the water, since its concentration is constant, it's no longer a KC. And remember, the subscripts don't mean anything other than a more clear explanation of what the equilibrium constant is all about. So a KC just tells you it's based on concentration. KA tells you it's an acid dissociation constant or an acid equilibrium constant. They're the same thing. In this case, the acetic acid dissociates to give you H plus and acetate ion. And H plus, because of that very small size and that very large charge, the ion dipole forces of attraction between H plus and H2O are so strong that there is no such thing really as H plus in water. There's probably not even H3O plus. Instead, I'm missing a bar on here. Instead, what you've got All right, computer, I'm tired of waiting for you. Thank you very much. Is you've probably got H9O4 with a plus one charge. What the heck is H9O4? It's H plus four water molecules. That H plus is such a concentrated charge, it's so small and so at a very dense charge, that four water molecules attach to it. This is ion dipole forces attraction that we talked about previously. Now, it gets to be such a hassle to write H9O4 plus that we're not going to bother. We're just going to stick with the simple H3O plus. Sometimes I may write H plus. H3O plus and H plus are the same thing. Okay? So you're going to see it both ways. As I said, Wednesday, the equilibrium constant value for that reaction is 1.8 times 10 to the minus 5. Because it's such a small value, what does it tell you? It tells you that if you start with acetic acid and you put it into water, in other words, you take a bottle of vinegar, some H3O plus and some acetate ion will be produced. But it's such a small amount, the ratio is 1.8 times 10 to the minus 5. The question is, how much is it? Well, let's do a calculation finally. Vinegar, by law, in order to call something vinegar, it has to be 5% acetic acid. Every single vinegar you buy will be 5% acetic acid. So let's calculate the pH of 5% acetic acid. Before we do that, let's do a much simpler question. What is the pH of 0.1 molar HCl. HCl is a strong acid. Acetic acid is a weak acid. If you were to calculate an equilibrium constant for HCl, its value would be virtually infinite. What does that mean? It means if I start with HCl and I put it into water, I get H3O plus and chloride ions 100%. So if you were to write the equilibrium reaction for this, if there was such a thing, it would look like this. The K for this reaction, would look like that. It's a Ka because I've absorbed the concentration of water, which is constant, into the equilibrium constant. And this is equal to an extremely large number because virtually all of the HCl breaks apart into ions. The difference between a strong acid and a weak acid is that strong acids completely dissociate into their ions, weak acids only dissociate a little bit. There is no relationship, and we're about to calculate it, between pH and acid strength. Just because something has a low pH does not tell you anything at all about the strength of the acid. I'll show you what I mean in a second. So back up to this question. What is the pH of 10th molar HCl? pH is defined as the negative log of the concentration of hydrogen ions. Okay? It's a base 10 scale. In other words, for every 10 unit change in concentration, the pH only changes by 1 unit. So if I double the concentration of H plus, I'll change the pH by 2. Or excuse me, if I multiply the concentration of H plus by 10, I'll change the pH by 1. If I multiply it by 100, I'll change it by 2. If I multiply it by 1,000, I'll change it by 3. Okay? So all we have to do here is the negative log, in this case, it's 1/10 molar HCl because it's a strong acid. I know that the concentration is 0.1 molar H plus. And so the negative log of 0.1 is 1. Can you get a pH that's 0 or less than 0? What if the concentration of H plus, what if you started with 1 molar HCl? What's the log of 1? 0. So can you get a pH of 0? Sure. What if I have 10 molar HCl? Then you take the negative log of 10. Well, what's the log of 10? 1. The negative log of 10 is negative 1. Yes, it is possible to get negative values for pHs. It's not very common. You don't usually work with concentrations that high, but it is possible. Usually you think about pHs as being from between 1 and 14. And we'll talk about why that is in a second. And I remember I asked you a question at the end of the class the last time. But we'll go back up to this question. What is the pH of vinegar if vinegar is 5% acetic acid? Well, we already know the equilibrium reaction for vinegar. It's acetic acid plus water. Oops. Start writing too fast and I make mistakes. My daughter changed the eraser on this thing. I got to change it back. All right. Ka equals well, if we want to get the pH, we need the hydrogen ion concentration. So I'm going to do some algebra on this, and I'm going to say, okay, the hydrogen ion concentration is equal to 1.8 times 10 to the minus 5 times the concentration of acetic acid over the concentration of COO minus. Somehow I've got to get those concentrations. All I know is it's 5%. Well, let's start there. 5%. What does that mean? It means that there are 5 grams of acetic acid in every 100 grams of vinegar. If I know that there's 5 grams of acetic acid in 100 grams of vinegar, vinegar is just acetic acid and water. The density equals 1. It's essentially water. 95% of it is water anyway, so the density is essentially that of water. It might be a little bit different than that, but it's close enough. So if we want the concentration of acetic acid, let's see, 5 grams of acetic acid in 100 grams of solution, 1 mole of acetic acid is 12, 15, 16, 28, and 32, 60 grams. So let's see, I've now got moles of acetic acid, so now I need liters. I've got 100 grams. Oops. One gram of solution for every milliliter of solution, that's the density. And I have 1 liter, or 1,000 milliliters, in 1 liter. So let's see, milliliters cancel, grams cancel. We now have moles per liter, which is what we want. So 5,000 divided by 60, right? Which is 500 divided by 6, which is what? 83 and a third. Is it really that high? Yeah, 500 divided by 6. No, divided by 100. There we go. There's 100 over here. So that's right, 0.833 molar. That I can believe. I do have to change this eraser. Hang on, let me fix my eraser. I don't remember where my eraser is. So that's the concentration of acetic acid. We needed that here. We still need the concentration of acetate ions. That's the hard part. Is there going to be very much acetate ions? No, there's not. There's got to be another way to get it. So this is where we introduce you to your favorite thing. Ice tables. You will be using ice tables from now until the end of March. I guarantee it. Okay? Once you get used to using them, they're very easy to use. Once you learn to use them, you use them the same way every time. The way that it works. Is there's my equation. I stands for the initial concentration, the change in concentration, and the equilibrium concentration. The initial concentration you get from the problem. In this case, we said it was 5% acetic acid. We just calculated that acetic acid is 0.833 molar. The water, we don't care about. It's going to be constant anyway, so who cares about it? When you first start, there's none of the H3O plus and none of the acetate ion. None of it is dissociated yet. None of it is reacted, so you just have acetic acid. You always get the initial concentrations from the statement of the problem. Okay? The change, the second row of this table, always comes from the balanced equation. Don't have to look anywhere other than the balanced equation. When this reacts, some of the acetic acid will react. For every mole of acetic acid that reacts, I will make a mole of acetate ions, and I will make a mole of hydronium ions. How do I know that? Because the balance equation tells me one acetic acid reacts to give me one H3O plus and one acetate ion. And so they have to have the same relationship. I put molarity for the concentration of the initial, but now I'm talking in terms of moles. But as long as the volume stays constant, molarity and moles are directly related to each other, so it's okay to do this. The last row of this table, the equilibrium row, this is where most people make their mistake. It always comes from adding the first two rows together. You always get the equilibrium row of this table by adding these two rows together. There are no exceptions. So at equilibrium, I will have the initial concentration of acetic acid plus the change that occurs, and that gives me the result. So 0.833 molar minus X equals 0.833 minus X. There is no acetic or acetate ion initially. There's no hydronium ion initially. So at 0 plus X equals X. If I go back and look at my Ka expression before I rearranged it, to show you the algebra. But now if I look at this, the equilibrium constant always takes the last row of that ice table and substitutes the values in for this. These are the equilibrium concentrations. So this is X times X divided by 0.833 minus X. I'm just copying it out of that ice table. And I know now that this is equal to 1.8 times 10 to the minus 5. From here, it's a question of how do you solve this? Well, it's not that tough. Let's see, we get x squared over 0.833 minus x equals 1.8 times 10 to the minus 5. X squared equals 1.8 times 10 to the minus 5 times 0.833 minus x. X squared minus plus 1.8 times 10 to the minus 5x minus, what's 1.8 times 0.833? That's close enough. So I've done a little bit of fast algebra there, but that's what I have to solve. Well, that's not hard. It's a quadratic equation. We all remember the quadratic equation. You all have that committed to memory, right? So you can solve the roots of this equation. Nah, it's too much work. We don't want to do that. There's an easier way. This is one way to solve this equation. You will then solve for the roots of the equation. You'll find out that one of the two roots, there are going to be two because there's a square root in there, makes sense. The other root will not make any sense. You pick the one that makes sense, and that's your answer. Okay? So if you want, you can always solve a quadratic equation to solve these problems. It will never be wrong to do that. If your calculator does it for you already, use it. That's fine. You have that tool, use it. However, I prefer to do it a little bit more simply. What does the size of that number tell you? It tells you you don't make a whole lot of product. Well, if you don't make a lot of product, back in my ice table here, X is my product, right? I'm not going to get very much of it. In fact, I get so little X that when I subtract out the size of X from the amount I started with, it doesn't change the amount I started with. 0.833 minus a very small number is 0.833. So we're going to make a simple assumption. Assume that 0.833, the initial, that equilibrium amount of the starting material minus the change is still equal to the initial amount. If we make that assumption, go back up here to what I had, and you look at this equation now, and you say, oh, okay, if I do that, then I can say that 1.8 times 10 to the minus 5 is approximately equal to x squared over 0.833. Well, now this becomes nice and simple, because so now x, when I make that assumption, makes the algebra becomes much easier. If I go back now and check, and I plug that in up there, 4 times 10 to the minus 3, 0.833 minus 4 times 10 to the minus 3 is going to be 0.829. Is that approximately equal to 0.833? Yeah, it is. The rule of thumb is 5%. Anytime the change is 5% or less, you can do it. Well, what's 5% of 0.833? 0.04. 10% is 0.08, so 5% would be 0.04. Well, this is 10 orders of magnitude less than that. So it's okay to make this assumption. It's a perfectly valid assumption. So we've just found out that x is equal to 3.9 times 10 to the minus 3. Now what do? We still haven't answered the question. The question was, what's the pH? Go back up to your ice table. X is my hydrogen ion concentration. And so my pH is the negative log of this number. And now before you punch the numbers on the calculator, what does the answer have to be between? Not what is it, just give me a range between two values that it has to be between. 0 and 7, that's good. Can you narrow it down more than that? Why is it 0 and 7, Susie? You're right. Because it's an acid. It's got to have a pH less than 7 if it's an acid. If you ever get a pH greater than 7 for an acid, you've done something wrong, folks. I don't care what acid it is, the pH will never be greater than 7. All right, so 0 and 7 is good. Can we narrow it down a little bit more? Thomas? Between 6 and 7. That's narrowed down, but it's a little It's shifted a little bit, not quite. How am I going to do this? What am I going to do? I'm going to look at this number and I'm going to say, I'm going to take the negative log of that number. Well, I can't take the negative log of 3.9 very easily. But I can take the negative log of 10 to the minus 3. What's the negative log of 10 to the minus 3? 3. And what if this number was 10 times 10 to the minus 3? Then it would be 10 to the minus 2. Well, you can all do the negative log of 10 to the minus 2 in your head, I hope. That is 2. So the answer better be between 2 and 3. If you're doing this on a multiple choice test, you won't need your calculator. What'd you get, a different value?
Well, there's no calculator on the MCAT.
There's no calculator on the MCAT. Oh, my God, you got to be able to do this in your head. It's multiple choice, though, so you look at this and you say, hey, I can't do the negative log of 3.9. But I can do the power of 10. So the answer has to be between 2 and 3. Guess what? On the MCAT, they're going to give you two choices between 2 and 3. So you narrowed it down to two choices. You need to know one more thing. What's the negative log of 5? This is a number you should commit to memory. It's 0.3. So if you put that one in your head and you say, okay, this number now is 3.9 times 10 to the minus 3. It's closer to minus 3 than it is to minus 2. So the pH is going to be 2 point something. And it's less than 5, so I bet it's going to be a little bit higher. What'd you get? 2.41. So you can narrow this one down. Of 0.5. What's the negative log of 0.5?
Okay.
Sorry. I remember it's 3. So I know that if this was 5 times 10 to the minus 3, the answer would have been 2.3. If you plug 5 times 10 to the minus 3 in, you get 2.3, right? So So I knew it was going to be greater than 2.3. Those are the kinds of things you need to know for the MCAT to be able to get these calculations right. Okay? Oh, sorry, that should be 1.5. How's that? What's 0.833 times 1.8 times 10 to the minus 5? Didn't you tell me it was 1.5? Yeah, this number times that number. I'm trusting Amelia over here. Yeah, that's right, okay. So all I did was multiply this number by 0.833 and I got 1.5. I just wrote it wrong here. This should have been 1.5. Just to demonstrate what I was saying about pH, that's 1.5, that's that number. Okay, I'll take 1.5. No. Okay, look at the algebra, folks. 0.833 times 1.8 times 10 to the minus 5 is 1.5 times 10 to the minus 5 equals x squared. So x is the square root of 1.5, all right? Here's your challenge question for today. What is the pH of 1.0 times 10 to the minus 8 molar HCl? Anybody got an answer? 7. It has to be less than 7, yes. If you think the answer is 8, you weren't listening 5 minutes ago when I said, I don't care what acid it is. If it's an acid and it's 25 degrees C, the pH has to be less than 7. Yes, I know the negative log of 10 to the minus 8 is indeed 8. But this is HCl. It's a strong acid. It completely dissociates. Why is the pH less than 7? Because water has a pH of 7. What is the equilibrium of water? When water dissociates, or when water reacts with itself, you get H3O plus and OH minus. The K for this reaction at 25 degrees C is 10 to the minus 14. It's a very, very small number. So if water dissociates, let's not take shortcuts here. Let's do it right. Do an ice table for water. We don't care about the water, so we don't even have to worry about it. Its concentration is constant. There's none of this and none of this. You get some of each of these, and so at equilibrium, you've got plus x for both of them. So k equals x squared. It's actually a kw. It's a specific equilibrium constant. It equals 1.0 times 10 to the minus 14. So x equals 1.0 times 10 to the minus 7. That's why the pH of water is 7. If you raise the temperature, you change the pH. Didn't I ask that on a test last year? That's what I thought. Okay. We'll come back to that one. So if I've got 10 to the minus 8 molar HCl, and I put HCl into water, I'm going to do it as though it were a weak acid, even though HCl is a strong acid. Okay. So far, all I've done is fill out an ice table. You'll get very good at doing these. We'll do a lot of them. Because it's a strong acid, what do I know about that? What is it equal to when the reaction's done? It's a strong acid, so HCl completely breaks apart. So when the reaction's done, at equilibrium, how much HCl do you have? Zero. So I know that 1.8 times 10 to the minus 8, 1.0 times 10 to the minus 8, minus x equals zero. So x equals 1.0 times 10 to the minus 8. Susie? I'm sorry? If it were at equilibrium, yes, but because this is a strong acid, this isn't really an equilibrium. Come on, eraser, work for me, thank you. It's that. But this is how you can show that what x is equal to. But then you have to say, wait a second. Anytime you've got ions, you have to have water. We're only going to deal with aqueous solutions. Well, if I have water, what's the concentration of H3O plus from water? 10 to the minus 7. So the concentration of H3O plus in this mixture has to be equal to the concentration of H3O plus from HCl plus the concentration of H3O plus from water. Usually we're going to ignore the water, but this is an instance where you can't. So that equals 1.0 times 10 to the minus 8 plus 1.0 times 10 to the minus 7, which equals 1.1 times 10 to the minus 7. And the pH is 6.97. So even though I have a very dilute solution of HCl, I still have an acidic pH, not very acidic. Which has the lower pH, vinegar or 10 to the minus 8 molar HCl? Vinegar. We just figured out its pH was, I can't remember, it was too long ago. 2.41, the pH of vinegar. The pH of 10 to the minus 8 molar HCl is 6.97. Which is the strong acid, HCl or acetic acid? HCl. It completely dissociates. Does pH tell you anything about acid strength? Not a thing. Just because something has a low pH or a high pH, it tells you nothing at all about the strength of the acid. The strength of the acid is determined by whether or not it dissociates into its ions, not what its pH is. Now, at the end of the period Wednesday, I gave you the following two reactions. NH3 plus water to give you NH4 plus plus OH minus. NH4 plus plus water to give you NH, did I do that right? Yeah, I did that right. Okay, and I said add the two reactions together. You get that reaction. We just looked at that reaction. What is that reaction? That's KW. KW equals 1.0 times 10 to the minus 14. If I write a dissociation reaction or an equilibrium constant expression for that second equation, what kind of K is it? It has this as a product. What kind of K is it? It's a Ka. For that top reaction, if I write the equilibrium constant expression for it, what kind of a K is it? Kb. For this pair of reactions, Ka times Kb equals Kw. The only time that is true is if you've got what are called conjugate acid-base pairs. And on Monday, we'll talk a little bit more about what those are. Okay? Have a great weekend. I'll see you on Monday.